కూజంతం రామ రామేతి మధురం మధురాక్షరం ఆరుహ్య కవితా శాఖాం వందే వాల్మీకి కోకిలం యత్ర యత్ర రఘునాథ కీర్తనం తత్ర తత్ర కృతమస్తకాంజలిం బాష్పవారి పరిపూర్ణలోచనం మారుతిం నమత రాక్షసాంతకం వైదేహీ సహితం సురద్రుమతలే హైమే మహామంటపే మధ్యే పుష్పకమాసనే మణిమయే వీరాసనే సుస్థితం అగ్రే వాచయతి ప్రభంజనసుతే తత్వం మునిభ్యః పరం వ్యాఖ్యాంతం భరతాదిభిః పరివృతం రామం భజే శ్యామళం. శ్రీ రామాయణ సిరీస్ పార్ట్ 22, ద పాదుకాస్ రెయిన్. వి సా దట్ భరత మెట్ రామ అండ్ ద సీన్ moved everyone's heart around. It was such an emotional moment when the two brothers met, the two brothers who had affection flowing in bounty for each other, met, embraced each other and exchanged words. It brought tears into the eyes of everybody present around. Not just that, even today when one reads that episode or listens to that episode, it definitely moves the soul. Rama got to know from Bharata about the departure of his father to the other world, and so he performed his last rites. After this, Bharata told Rama that, my dear elder brother, I have come to fetch you back to the kingdom of Ayodhya. Please come back and accept the throne and rule over the land. I shall stay in the forest instead of you and fulfill the vow that you have given to our father. I will stay in exile for 14 years. So that way you would not have broken the vow given to our father too. And regarding the second vow, the throne was given to me, but I am rejecting to take it. So you must come back for my sake. As I told the sages yesterday back in Ayodhya, that both the kingdom and me are your servants, and one servant cannot rule over the other. So you ought to come back, O Lord, said Bharata. Not only that, I am your brother, I am your disciple, and I am your servant. And if a brother, disciple or servant asks his master, guru or elder brother something, he must not refuse. So you need to accept this, said Bharata. To this Rama replied, see my dear brother, I understand your feelings. I understand how much of affection you have for me. But I have given a word to my father. And I have told Mother Kaikeyi, Ramo Dhirnabhibhashate. Rama has no two tongues. So there is no question of my going back on my words. It may so happen that the moon may lose its luster. The snow of the Himalayas can melt away completely, or even the oceans can cross their limits and flow into the land. But there is no chance of me going back on my words. Lakshmi Chandra Dapyatva Himavanimam Tyajet Atiyata Sagaro Velam Napratignam Aham Pituhu. I cannot go back on the words that I have given to my father. Come what may, I have to stay back here. And I shall do so for 14 years. And don't worry, my dear brother. 14 years will just fly off in no time. You go back and rule the land as per the wishes of Mother Kaikeyi and as per the commands of her father. You need to do it. And you need to fulfill your duty, which is a part of the moon granted too. So please go back and accept the throne. But Bharata said, that is impossible. I have no right over the throne because I am your property. And when the master is away in exile, how can the property rule? I cannot do that. So you ought to come back. So saying, Bharata laid down a piece of grass and said, I shall sit here and fast till you accept what I want you to accept. Now the sages around saw this situation and they felt that nothing was going to work out. Both the brothers were adamant. Rama was adamant not to come back. And Bharata was adamant not to go back without Rama. So, what could be the solution to this? At this time, sage Vasishtha came up with an optimal solution. He said, Bharata doesn't want to ascend the throne, which is acceptable. He feels so much for Rama. He feels so subordinated to Rama that he doesn't want to take charge. That's fine. That is accepted. That should be given regard. At the same time, Rama too doesn't want to sacrifice his vow for anything, which is also highly respectable. So, the via media solution would be to take the padukas or the sandals of Rama, place them on the throne and make the sandals the ruler. That would be a representative of Rama himself, and the actual rule would be, the administration would be carried out by Bharata. So when Vasishtha suggested this, both Bharata and Rama agreed in their minds and hearts and said that their resolve was still being satisfied and there was a solution which came up too. So Bharata very respectfully took the sandals of Rama, placed them on his head and headed towards Ayodhya. Before going, he told Rama that I shall rule under the headship of the Padukas as the servant of the Padukas, as the servant of your Padukas. I shall carry out the administrative affairs as her representative. And I shall do so for 14 years. If you do not return on the day stipulated after the 14 years are over, I shall sacrifice myself by jumping into the fire. I shall do Agni Pravesha. So you please come back, my dear brother, on the stipulated date when 14 years are exactly over. You ought to come back. And one more thing. I shall not enter the palace and live like a king all these 14 years. When my brother is in the forest living like a hermit, I shall also do the same. I am his servant. So I shall live in the outskirts of the city in a place called Nandigrama, like an ascetic, wearing bark robes, wearing matted locks, and live the life of a hermit and carry out my duty of administration alone as a representative for the Paduka, as the servant of Rama's Padukas. So saying, he took the sandals of Rama on his head. Adhirohaaryapadabhyam paduke hemabhushite etehi sarvalokasya yogakshemam vidasyataha. When Bharata alighted the Padukas onto his head, it is said that the entire world was going to get peace and prosperity. The Padukas were installed on the throne, and Swami Deshikan says in his Paduka Sahasram that when the coronation of the Padukas happened, sacred water was poured over the Padukas, and this water actually cooled the land of Ayodhya. It gave a soothing effect to the land of Ayodhya itself, which was burning with virahatapa or pangs of separation because of the departure of Rama to the forest. Annaya Rama virahat parikhinna vritte ashvasanaya bhavati manipada rakshe tirtha abhishekam apadishya vasundharayaha chakretada samuchitam shishiropacharam. The land which suffered because of separation from Rama really got a cooling, relieving effect because of this ablution of the Padukas. Now, it may so happen that some people may have an objection that how can the sandals of a person rule? Swami Deshikan very beautifully gives an answer for this in his Paduka Sahasram. Raja Sane Ched Bhavati Nishanna Rangesha Padamani Tanna Chitram Yatra Dirudhaha Kramasha Puratvam Uttam Sayante Raghusarva Bhaumaha. Initially, who was to be coronated? The person who took the sandals on his head was to be coronated. So, if the sandals is going to be on the head of a person, obviously it is superior to that person. So, why cannot it be coronated? Somebody who bore the sandals on his head himself was to be coronated. Bharata was to be coronated. And the Padukas were placed on his head. So, why not? Why should they not be coronated? Like this, Paduka Sahasram speaks about many aspects of Sri Rama's Paduka. Paduka Sahasram is an excellent work composed in a part of a night by Swami Deshikan. It comprises of 1008 shlokas. 1008 shlokas were composed in just about one third of a night by Swami Deshikan. Such was his poetic skill and devotion to the Padukas of Lord Ranganatha. And these Padukas of Lord Ranganatha are none other than the Padukas of Lord Rama, which were carried by Bharata and installed on the throne in order to rule over Ayodhya in the 14 years during Rama's absence. It is said that the reign of the Padukas was supreme. It was even better than the reign of Rama, which was to happen after he finished his exile and came back. It is said, Varshani tani vrishalo na tapamsi tepe balo na kaschida pimrityu vasham jagama rajyeta vamba raghupungava padarakshe naiva param prativideyam abhut prasaktam. Swami Deshikan says, O Mother Paduka, your reign was superior even to Rama's reign, because all through your reign there was no member of the fourth Varna who performed penance. There was no young boy who died prematurely. And there was no untoward incident ever occurring which needed a ritual atonement. It so happened that these things happened during Rama's reign. Rama's reign was also a very, very celebrated one. It is very highly spoken of as the Rama Rajya. But it had certain shortcomings, like there was a person of the fourth Varna who did penance. There was somebody who did penance who was not supposed to do. He was not eligible to do penance, but he did. Such a thing happened during Ramarajya. And because of this act, a young boy died prematurely in Ramarajya. And there were some incidents which needed a ritual atonement to be sanctified. Now all these things never happened in the Paduka Rajya. There was nobody who did penance who was not supposed to. Anybody who was not supposed to do something never did that during the Paduka Rajya. And there was nobody who died prematurely in the Paduka Rajya. And everything was so righteously happening that there was no need of doing any kind of prayaschitta or parihara or ritual atonement of remorse. There was no need for that at all because everything was going so right. Such was the greatness of the Paduka Rajya, which was even better than Rama Rajya itself, it is said. So, having alighted the Padukas on the throne, the Padukas started reigning with the able assistance of Bharata, who lived the life of a hermit, discharging his duties as an administrator for the sake of Rama's Padukas. With this, the second canto or second kanda of Ramayana, the second unit of Ramayana called as Ayodhya Kanda, comes to an end. In the next part, we shall start with the third kanda, the Aranya Kanda. Kujantam Rama Rameti Madhuram Madhuraksharam Aruhya Kavita Shakham Vande Valmiki Kokilam Yatra Yatra Raghunatha Kirtanam Tatra Tatra Krita Mastakanjalim Vashpavari Paripurna Lochanam Marutim Namataraksha Santakam Vaidehi Sahitam Suradrumatale Haime Mahamantape मध्ये पुष्पकमासने मणिमये वीरासने सुस्थितम् अग्रे वाचयति प्रभञ्जनसुते तत्त्वं मुनिभ्यः परम् व्याख्यान्तं भरतादिभिः परिवृतं रामं भजे श्यामलम्. द रामायण सीरीज पार्ट 23 सरेंडर बाय द सेजेस. आफ्टर हैंडिंग ओवर द ग्लोरियस पादुकास टू भरत, रामा सीता एंड लक्ष्मण प्रोसीडेड ऑन देयर जर्नी इन द फॉरेस्ट. They proceeded towards Dandakaranya, the dense forest. And on their way, they met sage Atri and his wife Anasuya Devi. And it is said that Anasuya Devi became very fond of Sita. And she told Sita to narrate the episode of her wedding to her, which Sita Devi did elaborately. And then Anasuya Devi very affectionately presented a lot of jewels to Sita Devi, which she wore and shone even more bright in that darkness of the Dandakaranya forest. The way these three walked through the forest is explained very beautifully in a verse of the Valmiki Ramayana. Agratav prayau ramaha Sita madhye sumadhyama Prishthatastu dhanushpani Lakshmanonu jagamaha. In front went the great Rama. In the middle was Sita. And they were followed by Lakshmana, who came along with a bow and arrows. This particular format of Rama going in front, Sita being in the middle, and Lakshmana at the end of the trio denotes the pranava, it is said. The pranava is something very, very important in all kinds of scriptural, religious and sacred aspects. It is supposed to heal everybody. It is supposed to be sitting on top of the Vedas and it is supposed to contain all meanings present in the universe within itself. That one word, pranava, has everything. The pranava consists of three letters, A, U and Ma. And in this shloka, it can be seen that the letter A represents the great supreme being, that is Rama here. And that is denoted in this shloka as Agratav Prayayav Ramaha. It begins with the letter A. The next letter in the pranava is U, and this U denotes the connecting link between the Supreme Being and us. And who is this connecting link? It is none other than the consort of the Supreme Being, that is the consort of Rama in this case, Sita Devi. And when Sita is described in this verse, it is said Sita Madhye Sumadhyama. So the sound of Ukara is reflected in this part of the verse. And then the third part of the pranava is Ma. And this Ma denotes us jivatmas, us souls. And that has been denoted in this shloka as Lakshmanonu jagamaha. The letter Ma comes there. And Lakshmana is described to be following with the bow and arrow, Prishthatastu Dhanushpani, they say. Why? Because the role of this soul is to be of service to the Lord. The way Lakshmana was doing service to the Lord without fail, always, whenever the Lord was awake, asleep, or whatever he was doing, Lakshmana was into service of the Lord. That is the very nature, swarupa of this soul. So, Lakshmana, being a representative of all souls, stands for the letter Ma here, which has been very beautifully denoted in this shloka. So, like this, they walked in the Dandakaranya forest, with Rama proceeding first, followed by Sita, and followed by Lakshmana, who wielded the bow and arrows. As they were walking across the Dandakaranya forest, many sages came and met them. And these sages were apparently in a very troubled state because they were tormented by many augurs who were not letting them perform their sacrificial rituals. So they all came and told Rama that they were in a very bad state and that they needed protection. They needed protection from a king, whether he was in the city or in this forest. Rama was still their king, they thought. So what if he had come to the forest? He was duty bound to protect them. So they sought his protection. Devayam bhavata rakshya bhavad vishayavasinaha nagarasthova vanasthova tvamno raja janeshwara. We being your citizens deserve your protection, whether you are in the city or in the forest. Tatastvam sharanartham cha charanyam samusthitaha paripalayano rama vadhyamana nishacharaihi. You have to cater to us who have come surrendering to you, seeking protection from the Rakshasas. You have to get rid of them and save us, they said. Rama felt very sad on hearing this, it seems. Rama was really disturbed. Why was he disturbed? Was he disturbed because these sages were asking him to work even when he was on exile? Was he sad because he was wondering how to handle Rakshasas without an army? Was he sad because he had already left everything and he himself was walking in the forest, barely having anything with him, and he was sought as a refuge by some great sages? What was the reason? Rama answered saying that, I am feeling miserable that you people had to come asking this to me. I should have done it myself without you having to ask. I should have volunteered to protect you. In fact, I should have come rushing from Ayodhya to protect you without you, even you people having thought of me. The moment danger lurked around you, I should have been present to protect you. That is the very reason why I was to be anointed as king by my father. Fine, now I feel that the very reason why my father sent me to the forest was to save you people from the Rakshasas. Naivam arhatamam vaktum agnyapyoham tapasvinam pitastu nirdeshakaraha pravishtohamidam vanam. It looks like my father has sent me to the forest only for this purpose. And O sages, you being respectful both by age, position and penance, should not be requesting me like this. You ought to order me. Agnyapyoham tapasvinam, he says. Please order that Rama, get rid of these sages. They are troubling us. You should not come and seek protection from me. You should just order. I am your son. I am your king. I am at your beck and call. So please tell me that, says Rama. This is why Swami Deshikan very beautifully describes this incident in his Mahavira Vaibhavam, calling Rama a Parijata tree. That is a wish-granting tree. Dandaka tapovana jangama parijata, he says. Rama was so ready to grant whatever people wanted that he did not even want them to ask for it. If it was for a righteous purpose, he felt that it was his duty to come forward by himself and protect. That way, he was a parijata tree, a wish-granting tree like the Kalpaka Vriksha. And any tree like the Kalpaka or Parijata would be stationary. It would be sthavara, that is stationary, immobile. But here Rama was coming mobile. He came walking all the way to where the rishis were and granted them protection. So he was a jangama Parijata, the mobile Parijata tree, the mobile wish granting tree. It is said that when the sages heard this from Rama, they felt really happy and satisfied. And once they had poured their heart out, now they saw the beautiful form of Rama in front of them. They saw so handsome he is. Though he is clad only in bark garments, though he is wearing matted locks, though he is dressed like a sage, prosperity, auspiciousness, and heavenly beauty is dazzling out from his personality. Rupasamhananam Lakshmim Saukumaryam Suveshatam Dadrishuhu Vismitakaraha Ramasya Vanavasinaha. Everybody around in that forest actually fell for Rama at the time, it seems. What an auspicious form. Rupasam Samhananam Lakshmim Saukumaryam. So wonderful, so soft, so graceful. Suveshatam. Even this dress that he is wearing is so suitable for him. The dress has become beautiful because he is wearing it. So they all became literally crazy for him at that time. They fell for Rama, it seems. And it is said in commentaries that these rishis actually called Rama aside. And they knew that he was the Paramapurusha. He was the supreme being. He was the one to be sought by everyone as all relationships. So they actually secretively requested him, it seems, whether he could become their master, their spouse, making them females. To which Rama answered that this was not the time for it. In this particular incarnation or avatara, he had taken a vow to be Ekapatni Vrata, that is having a single wife. He was to take another avatara very soon, the Krishna avatara, wherein these sages could all come as Gopikas and have the kind of experience that they desired now. So the sages were happy, and it is really said that these sages came later as the Gopikas during Krishna avatara and got the kind of divine experience that they wanted now from Rama. So like this, the sages surrendered to Rama, and Rama granted them protection, granted them their desirous fruit in all possible manners, and he was to get rid of these evil augurs. To begin with, the first augur that he battled with was Viradha. Viradha, the demon, took away Sita like a wind, and he dropped her somewhere, and Rama and Lakshmana went running behind Viradha. So he dropped Sita and picked these two up, and then they had a fierce battle with Viradha, and finally Rama told Lakshmana to dig a pit, and Rama stood there laying his foot on the neck of Viradha as the pit was being dug. So he actually hunted Viradha in the way a tiger would hunt a deer. So this is described beautifully by Swami Deshikan when he says, Viradha Harina Shardula. Like a tiger would hunt a deer, Rama hunted Viradha and got rid of that demon. Like this, there were many challenges going to come up in this Aranya, Dandaka Aranya. And how Rama faced each one of them with great valor will be described in the forthcoming parts. Kujantam Rama Rameti Madhuram Madhuraksharam Aruhya Kavita Shakham Vande Valmiki Kokilam Yatra Yatra Raghunatha Kirtanam Tatra Tatra Krita Mastakanjalim Bashpavari Paripurna Lochanam Marutim Namatarakshasantakam Vaidehi Sahitam Suradrumatale Haime Mahamantape Madhye Pushpakamasane Manimaye Veerasane Sustitam Agrevachayati Prabhanjanasute Tattvam Munibhyah Param Vyakhyantam Bharatadibihi Parivritam Ramam Bhajeshyamalam. The Ramayana series, part 24, Selfless Service. After reaching Dandakaranya, Rama met many sages who surrendered to him seeking protection from the Rakshasas in Dandakaranya. Rama reassured them that it was his primary duty to protect them from these Rakshasas, and that he would kill them and thus save the sages from the wrath of those augurs. After Rama gave this word to the sages, they were walking towards the hermitage of Sutikshna, and after visiting that sage, they proceeded walking along the Dandakaranya. And as they proceeded, Sita Devi spoke to Rama and said the following words. She said, "O Lord, I know that you know what is righteous and you only do anything after giving it due thought. But I am afraid that this time you have given your word to the ascetics because of having weapons with you now." Rama was puzzled. He did not understand. He said, "What are you trying to say?" She said, "See, we have come to the forest on the purpose of fulfilling the vow of your father. We are in exile and I think we should just dwell in the forest and go back. Why to kill anybody unnecessarily, be it innocent birds, animals or even augurs for that matter? Why simply to kill anybody? Sita Devi was so compassionate that she did not want anybody to be destroyed at any time. So she was not happy with Rama wanting to kill the ogres. So she said that I think you have got this idea of being violent and killing only because you are having weapons with you." And to support this idea of hers, she gave him a small anecdote. She told him a short story. She said, "Once upon a time, there was a sage who was very, very committed to his ascesis and who would not be distracted by anything and would concentrate only on his penance. Somehow, Indra got scared that this sage would acquire his position by his merit of penance. So he wanted to prevent that. In order to prevent that, he tried many aspects like sending apsaras and giving him gifts and trying to create noise and do away with his penance. Nothing worked. Then finally he devised a plan and he came in the guise of a traveler who was traveling across the forest with a sword in hand. Indra came as a traveler with a sword in hand and he came to the hermitage of this sage and told him that, "O sage, please keep this sword with you. I am scared to take it along with me because I heard that there are robbers in this forest and this sword is very specially given to me by my relatives and it has been told that anybody who possesses this sword will never face defeat in his life. So I want this sword to be safeguarded, but at the same time I don't want to carry it across the forest. I have to cross the forest and reach the town on the outskirts. I have some job there. I will finish that in a couple of days and return back. And on the way back, I shall take the sword. I don't want to be robbed of this sword." He said this, he sang great praises of that sword and gave it to that sage and left. And he never came back after 2 days. The sage very sincerely safeguarded that sword. And when this traveler did not return back after 2 days, he thought he will return maybe after a few more days. Like that, a week passed by, 2 weeks passed by, and almost a month passed by. By this time, the sage became curious about this sword. He kept recalling the words of the traveler when he praised the sword so much. He said, "What is so special about this sword? Let me have a look." And then he slowly touched the sword. Then he lifted the sword and he felt it was all nice and shiny. How would it be to use? He thought. "Let me try cutting an apple with this sword." And he actually cut an apple. He thought, "It is so sharp, it cuts wonderfully." Then he cut many fruits that were present surrounding him. At that time, suddenly a cat jumped into his hermitage. In a fit of reaction, he just cut the cat with the sword. And slowly, with the sword, he started cutting everything and everyone around. And the sage became a sinner in no time. What was the reason? The reason was possession of the wrong item. What is the use of a sage having a sword? Why should it be present there? Only because he had this sword in hand, his mind got deviated from his penance, from his virtues, from his righteousness. That object in hand turned out to be a temptation which he couldn't resist. And that actually turned the tables around in a most disastrous manner for the sage. this story Sita Devi is telling Rama now. And then she said, I feel only because you have weapons in hand, you seem to have forgotten that our purpose of having come to the forest is not to slay anybody, but to just dwell here, be in exile and go back. Since you have weapons in hand, you seem to have forgotten this and you seem to have got tempted to go and slay somebody, even if it be the ogres. Rama listened intently to the way Sita narrated and he was enjoying every bit of it. After she finished, he looked at Lakshmana and said, see Lakshmana, how beautifully your sister-in-law is talking. Who can talk like her? So nicely she narrated and supported her cause with an anecdote too. But my dear Sita, now he looked at Sita and said, you know something, I have given a word to these sages because they are my people and they need protection from me. Moreover, I am not going to kill any innocent being. I am going to kill only the ones who deserve to be punished because they are troubling the virtuous ones. And above all, I have given my word to the sages. I may give up on anything. I may give up my life. I may even give you up, who is more precious than my own life. Or I may even give up Lakshmana, who is even more precious than that. But I cannot give up my word. Apyaham jivitam jahyam tvam vasite cha Lakshmana natu pratignyam samsmritya brahmanebhyo visheshataha. I cannot go back on my words given to anybody, especially to the Brahmanas. I may even give up my own life, you or Lakshmana. But I cannot go back on my words. Like this, Rama said his pratignya was so important because it was something that gave solace to another person. So something which gives solace to the other person cannot be taken back by me at any cost. So I will be of service to the sages. Thus Rama showed his attitude of selfless service to righteousness here. There was one more person who was doing selfless service all this while, who's been doing selfless service ever since Rama was born. Who was that? Lakshmana. And his selfless service is also seen in this scenario, because after Rama declared that he would be killing the ogres, they decided to settle down in that vana of Dandakaranya and wait for the ogres to come so that they could go and battle with the ogres and slay them. So at that time, Rama told Lakshmana that, oh Lakshmana, please find out a place which is liked by you, which is liked by Sita, and if it is comfortable, you make a parnashala, a hut there, and we shall all go there and live. Ramate yatra vaidehi tvamaham chaiva lakshmana tadrisho drishyate deshaha sannikrishta jalashayaha. Go and look for a place near where water is present and which is liked by you, me and Sita Devi. When Lakshmana heard these words, he had tears in his eyes, it seems. Rama was startled. He said, what happened, my dear brother? Are you tired of working? If that is so, please sit. I will do all the work. Then Lakshmana said, no, brother. How could you even think of asking about my liking for choosing a place for residence? Who am I? What am I? I am your servant. I am your object of service. My intention, my liking, my desire, etc. don't exist at all. Because everything is yours. All that is mine belongs to you. So there is no separate existence of mine here. Leave alone my desire, my liking. How could you even say that I should look out for a place of my liking? I will only look at what you want and do what you want. I am that submitted to your cause. I am your sesha. I am your dasa. Paravanasmika kutstha tvai visheshatam stite swayam tu ruchire deshe kriyatamiti mamvada. What you must say is, do this Lakshmana. You should order me. Kriyatamiti mamvada. Not ask me for opinions or my liking. You please accept me as your complete Seshabhuta. It is said that Lakshmana was the incarnation of Adisesha, the divine serpent of Lord Vishnu. And Adisesha means the ever submissive one who wanted to be submissive in all forms, at all places, at all times, and do all kinds of selfless service. So he said, Kriyatam iti mam vada, just tell me what to do and I shall do. This is why Lakshmana is called Lakshmana, it seems. Lakshmano Lakshmi Sampannaha, it is said. Lakshmana is the one who has Lakshmi in abundance, who has prosperity in abundance. And what is the Lakshmi that he had, the prosperity he had? The prosperity he had was the prosperity of service called Kaikarya Shri. Listening to these wisdom-laden words of Lakshmana, his selflessness, Rama couldn't control himself. He too had tears in his eyes and he tightly embraced his brother and said, Bhavagnena Kritagnena Dharmagnena Chalakshmana Tvaya Putrena Dharmatma Nasamvritta Pitamama. Lakshmana, the way you do service to me, knowing my emotion, Bhavagnena Kritagnena, you do service in the way it is to be done. You know the method to do perfect service. Not only that, you do service with so much affection that sometimes I doubt if you are my younger brother or my own father, Dasharatha. Tvaya putrena dharmatma nasamvritta pitamama. I feel it is my father, Dasharatha, who has come here to take care of me. I have no words to retaliate your service, my dear brother. And so saying, he tightly embraced Lakshmana. Atisnigdham chagadham parishvango mayakritaha. This kind of selfless service was shown by the servant of the Lord, who himself was keen upon doing selfless service to his devotees. What to say of these wonderful characters of the Ramayana, who teach us beautiful values of life? What is that we are supposed to do in life? We are supposed to be selflessly committed to the cause of welfare of righteous people. And this is taught in this beautiful legend called the Ramayana. What happened once they settled down in this Parnashala of Dandakaranya, we shall see in the next part.